Let's go to our Wednesday wrangle now and catch up with Liz Storer and Justin Smith, both in lockdown in their respective cities. Great to talk to both of you. I want to pick up on the first topic. Let's go to you, Justin, given that you're in Melbourne, and the suggestions that Daniel Andrews will say that a vaccine passport might be required to turn up at the MCG or at Marvel Stadium or the like.
Gee, it's rough, isn't it? It's rough. And you could see, you know, in that press conference, he really didn't want to, you know, commit to that. He really was rather that he wasn't asked that question. But you get the feeling that it's very much on the table. Gee, that'd be rough, wouldn't it? I mean, after the rollout that we've had, after the confusion that we've had around the jab, and what you can have and when you can have it, and also the way people have been feeling about it, it'd be a big stretch to say to them, hey, listen, we're going to ban you from these places and unless you stick the needle in your arm. That's rude. I think that's getting a little rude.
I reckon it's pretty rough, and it's up to... I think we all should have the opportunity to get vaccinated, but in the end, it's our choice, and if you've got good vaccination levels anyway, you shouldn't be that hard-nosed about it. Before I come to you, Liz, let's just have a look at what Daniel Andrews said on this yesterday. He didn't do a presser today. He handed over the reins to others, but here's what he said yesterday.
Once we've got many, many more people with the jab, we can then have a discussion about what that might mean for them. Freedom of movement, changes that deal with some of the risks that we face. Whilst ever we have, though, millions more people who want to get vaccinated than vaccines to put into their arms, I think it's a bit early for us to be talking about what those vaccines might actually entitle you to.
What do you reckon, Liz? This is a bloke who doesn't mind a bit of big government intrusion.
Look, I think this is far worse than rough. I think it's far worse than rude. I think it's patently wrong. These guys have been shoveling fear down the throats of the Australian populace for a good 18 months now, and they are now actively creating a second-class citizen in anyone who decides not to be immunised. They have taken away freedoms from us, freedoms which arguably were never theirs to take, and are now dangling them like a carrot in front of millions of healthy Australians, saying you will not get these back potentially unless you get this jab in your arm. The Australian Immunisation Handbook is abundantly clear that jabs are never to be given under any coercion of any sort, under any manipulation of any sort. And on a daily basis, this is what we are seeing from our national leaders. And I do fear, Chris, it's only going to get worse. And you've also got to ask yourself, where's the joke here? Because right now, fully immunised people in Australia have got a mask up just as much as the rest of us, are in lockdown just as much as the rest of us. Where's the benefits to getting vaccinated? They need to highlight the positives, which they are abjectly failing at right now, instead of constantly pushing this fear-laden drivel because people are getting sick of it, and so it's just not working half as well.
Yeah, you're right. There's no carrot there at the moment. There's a lot of talk about sticks, but there's no carrot. For instance, if you're fully vaccinated, there's no reduced requirement for quarantine and the like. But this is a massive issue, isn't it, Justin? This is more than what Daniel Andrews is going to do. This is a big debate around the country, in all the states, the federal government, around the world, just trying to put restrictions on people according to some sort of vaccine passport. And we've got to call it out and have the debate pretty wholeheartedly, because there could be all sorts of infringements on liberty.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, look, I agree with you. I just think we buggered it up so badly at the start, so badly, that we're now playing catch-up. And I just think that this talk about passports and this thing with Daniel Andrews, just way too much. Look, we're talking about the carrot and stick, and there's plenty of sticks and no carrot. Couldn't agree with that more. They've just buggered it up so badly. We've got to take it easy on people in this. People are really, really struggling through this. Let's just not make it any harder than it needs to be.
All right, let's check out something in Sydney. Liz, you're still locked down in Sydney, as I am. Our good friend James Morrow, one of the co-hosts of The Outsiders, has written in the Daily Telegraph about how Anthony Albanese is wandering around Queensland, not hanging out in his locked-down Sydney electorate. I say well played, Albo, but do you reckon that's a problem for him?
What would you do?
Honestly, look, I have nothing bad to say about this. He left to go for a two-week sitting week in Canberra, so he would have been gone for that amount of time anyway. And look, very few people return to a city that's locked down. They extend their holiday, they extend their work trip, they do what they can. And what would the guy have done if he were stuck back here in Sydney? He'd be locked up with the rest of us. So, and he's got another sitting two-week stint kicking off on, I think, the 3rd of August, so which he might have had to quarantine for if things escalate. So this was actually just pretty much common sense by Albanese here.
Yeah, I reckon well played, Albo. And it's good country for him to get around in Queensland anyway for all sorts of reasons. Justin, I was in your fair city 10 days ago and drove deliberately back into locked down city like a numbskull. My family, my wife and children, I flew them back to South Australia so they could... I could have gone back there as well. So, you know, I think more for me. And Albo's a bit smarter, although I've got to say my family are now locked down in South Australia.
Albo's problem is not what has happened. I think Albo's problem is that nobody misses him. That's the biggest concern. I don't know how the hell James picked up on it. To be frank, Albo's biggest problem is he has absolutely no cut through. And if he's not there, it's exactly the same as if he is there. So that's what I think he probably needs to work on.
He does need to work on that. It's a bit hard to cut through on anything but COVID at the moment. So at least James Morrow's done him the service, as you say, of getting his picture and his name in the paper. Now, before I let you go, I want to get your thoughts, each of you, briefly, starting with you, Liz, on whether $5 billion or whatever it's eventually going to be is worthwhile spending on the Olympics in southeast Queensland in 2032.
Look, it's hard to say. I mean, it is over a decade away. And I'm not across how much turnover is in an Olympic Games for you. You know, how much money did we make back out of the Sydney Games? Although, obviously, even since then, times have changed greatly in terms of how far your money can go. So I can't say that this is my field of expertise, but $5 billion, considering what we spend on some other things, which I won't go into, I mean, look, is it worth it? I don't know. I'd have to let the taxpayer say on that one.
I think the thing is, Justin, that money, public money and debt, it's just meaningless now. It is absolutely meaningless. For instance, we talk about $5 billion as a big deal. This country has spent $2.5 billion already just on COVID tests. And we've spent $150 billion on JobKeeper and those sort of things. So they're just racking it up. So what's $5 billion for the Olympics?
Yeah, look, I know the two of you want me to say something like, hey, think of how many electric cars we could buy for $5 billion.
But you're thinking it, Justin.
You're thinking it. But I'm kind of, look, it's simple as this. $5 billion is not a lot of money if you make $10 billion from it. So, but I have no idea. And I don't think we're going to know what position we're going to be in 2032. I think we're probably at more risk to actually let it go. Do we have it yet? I don't think we know yet, do we?
I think we're going to know at 6:30 tonight, mate. We're only about 90 minutes or so away from a decision. So that'll be coming up here live on the station soon. In fact, I'll be crossing to Tokyo after the next break. But what I should do first is say goodbye to you guys. Good to talk to you, Liz and Justin.
Thanks, Chris.
Hang in there through lockdown and talk to you next week.
We shall do.